Let's start today with a little bit of singing. Everybody please stand up. Major triad here, C, E, and G. And then a major major seventh from C to B natural. Now, a minor seventh chord. So Jane, how is a minor seventh chord built? Minor seventh. Good. So Dylan, how would we change this to make it a minor seventh chord? Good. So you make it a C minor triad. It's already a major seventh.
Flat the B. Yeah.
Yeah, flat the B. Good. Then you get a minor seventh. C, B flat. Okay, and then Ryan, how do we create a dominant seventh chord? What's it made up of? So a major triad and so what kind of seventh? Major or minor seventh? So, and then Fran, how would we change this to make it a dominant?
What do we need to do? Change which part?
So, yeah, right now it's just like a major seventh chord.
You would flat the seventh.
Good. So you have a major triad and a minor seventh for dominant. Okay, and then Michael, how do we construct a half diminished seventh chord?
You lower the third and the fifth.
Okay, so that's for the triad, the diminished triad, no bother. What about the seventh?
You need to lower the seventh as well. A half seventh.
Right, so that is some kind of seventh?
Minor
seventh. And it's called half diminished because the triad is diminished, but the seventh is not diminished. And then the other thing? So we call it half diminished because the triad on the bottom is diminished, but the seventh is a minor seventh. So it's not diminished. So only half of it is diminished. And then Daniel, how about a fully diminished seventh chord?
Take the half diminished and flat the seventh chord.
Exactly.
Lower seventh.
Good. So in this case, the minor seventh is already B flat, so we would need to make it be double flat to correctly notate this chord. So this. Again, I want to warn you guys against correcting things to make it look nicer. So, if you were going to write a root position C fully diminished seventh chord, this is not the right answer. Even though the B double flat and A natural are the same note and harmonically, this is a different seventh chord. This one would be an A fully diminished seventh chord in first inversion. This is C fully diminished in reposition. So we went over that. Feels like it was a while ago now already, because last would be missed class and then in term. But so these are the five different types of seventh chords that we find commonly in classical music. Any questions about these? We're gonna go over all of these as we do what we're mainly going to do today. Alright, so if you have your score anthology, I'd like you to get it out and turn to page 11. As usual, if you don't have it here, you're going to move and be on somebody else's.
What page?
Page 11. In general, when we have triads, if you're looking at, say, a music that has four parts, like a choral piece. In general, the note that would double in a triad will be the root note, whatever that is. And that's true here. He does double, Bach doubles the root. There's five notes, and he doubles also the E. There's an E in the middle, and then there's an E on top. The E on top functions kind of like a soprano melody. Even though it's broken up in the accompaniment, we hear that note kind of moving against the bass. Good. All right, so Stephanie, let's look at measure two of this chord. So how many different notes are there in this? Note names are there?
Four.
What are they? So you said A, F natural, D, and C. Good. And can you rearrange these so that they are like in a seventh chord, like ascending thirds?
Yeah. So when you're dealing with seventh chords that are neatly behaved like this, they're all just as close together as possible, you can look at the shape and you can tell what inversion it is pretty easily. But when you're dealing with real music, when the notes are spread out farther or there's more than four notes, then the rule of thumb is whatever is in the lowest voice, whatever is in the bass, that's what determines the inversion. So that's very important idea going forward. All right, and Linda, looking at this next chord, what notes do we have here?
B, D, E, F.
B, D, G, F. Okay, and then with those, if you rearrange them so that they're in ascending thirds, what?
G, B, E, F.
G, B, D, F. Good. How would we analyze this chord? First inversion. What is the numbers first inversion?
6-5.
So here in this one, you put the big five and then 6-5. And so we take all four note names, we rearrange them so we know what seventh chord it is, and then we look at what notes in the bass to determine what the inversion is. So the third, B, is in the bass. That means it's in first inversion. And then we use 6-5. And don't forget, so if you have problems remembering these numbers, call the hotline. 1-800-765-4342. The inversion number is all right, correct order. Nelson, do you have a question?
How do you tell the inversion?
Yeah, like I said, when you're looking at real music, and it gets harder the larger the ensemble, like an orchestra, it's hard to analyze. You need to find whatever note is in the bottom, or for especially complex music, you need to figure out what note sounds like it's in the bottom. Like if you're analyzing something like a Mahler symphony, and sometimes that it gets tricky because, you know, the double basses are in the bottom of the score, but then the tubas are like up here, and the contrabassoon is up here. And the contrabassoon might be the actual bass, not the one that's on physically in the bottom of the page. But when we're looking at piano music or choral music or string quartets, then in general the bottom line will be the bottom note. Okay, and then in C, the next chord, what do we have? we have the same chord as the first bar. So these first four bars are a little bit self-contained. They basically form the little phrase. And like a lot of chromatically altered chords, kind of chord, we would call it a secondary dominant. And what that means, if you look at the next chord here, Nelson, what's looking at this chord here, what chord do we have? Yeah, so as we just said it, we have a pair of chords, first inversion, triad, third inversion, seventh chord. First inversion, triad, third inversion, seventh chord. At the same time, in the top voice, we have the same melody, same melodic motion, just going down a fifth and going down a fifth. Now in music, when we have basically the same exact pattern, but just moved down or up by a step. We call this special kind of situation we call a sequence. A sequence, as you can see here, there's this pattern, the bottom, bottom, and then the chords also move in the same pattern of the piece. It's just, first it's on this one step and then moves down a step. So these four chords here form a sequence. So C major is in there, but what's this note on the bottom?
Okay, so it's a third version of harmony. So.
No, don't get ahead of yourself. What's the note on the bottom? What's its name?
A.
A. And then, what's this one?
C.
C.
E.
D.
G.
M.
C.
C. So A, C, E, and G, and C. So C is repeated. A, C, E, G. That's actually already in root position. A, C, E, G. So this one is built off of A. And then looking at this, Sion, what's the quality of the seventh chord?
It's a minor seven.
Good. So here we have, because it's in root position, we actually have a seventh chord in root position here, so we have the number seven there. All right, and then here, Gabe, we have this chord now. This one is spaced a little differently than any chord we've seen so far, so it can be good to just start at the bottom and kind of read up, just listing the note names. So what's the
D A D F sharp C.
D A D F sharp C. Good. Have we seen this chord already?
I guess it's by the way you phrase
it. So this is the only second time we've had an accidental, and it's the same one, F sharp before, F sharp again.
Oh, so it's the fifth, the dominant of the fifth.
Right. And then, because we have a C on top, it's a dominant seventh chord. And then because we have D on the bottom, it's in root position. So, put a seven there. And, yeah, and then Jane, I guess, back. So this one here. This is another, remember we analyzed this chord here, like that, as a secondary dominant. I just forgot to put that part there. This is another, with the F sharp here, it's another secondary dominant chord. So what's the chord after that? Good, so this is a dominant triad, and is it, what inversion is it? Root, fifth. Alright, so, kind of a dotted line here. So we have three, basically, so far we have these, this three-part phrase in the piece that takes us from the beginning order of one, and by the end of it, we have arrived at five, which is our dominant chord. And what happens here two chords, they form a certain kind of harmonic pattern that we call, does anybody know that, what we call that? We haven't really covered this yet, but some of you know, might have studied this before. Here, we have five, essentially, if we're thinking in G major, this is 5-1. This kind of progression, this part of it, we call the cadence. There are many different kinds of cadences, but cadence is the end of a musical idea, when the harmonies involved in a musical phrase will resolve. And sometimes the resolution can be weak, and sometimes it can be stronger, and it depends on what kind of cadence we have. This one is fairly strong, because 5-1 is the strong kind of cadence, so we call it authentic cadence. But because the upper voice, the top voice, doesn't end on scale 3-1, it's not as strong as it could be. So this is a weaker, strong cadence. And we'll talk about these terms more later. But, so this kind of wraps up this first arc of this piece, getting to 5. All right, let me get into some more chromatic stuff, which is fun. All right, so Dylan, what about this next chord here?
All right, so it's, it should be C, G, D, or C sharp, G, which is a diminished triumph and long. And I guess, I'm not entirely sure, but it's 4 half steps between B flat and C sharp. It's the second.
So of the 5 kinds here, which one does this seem to be?
It's a fully diminished.
Yeah, it's a fully diminished. So B flat, C sharp to B flat is a diminished
okay.
Second. If you were to invert that, you'd have an augmented second, B flat to C sharp. Yeah, so we have a fully diminished seventh chord now. And this is, we have now two non-diatonic notes, B flat and C sharp. And just like over here, these notes in this chord are part of a chord that connects to a chord that does appear normally in C major. And Ryan, what chord is that here?
DFA.
Yeah. So that's in DFA would be a what scale would be? Yeah, second. 2. But then what notes in the bottom? F. So what inversion would that be? So this is the third chord that would make it. So the seven.
So little seven, and that would be.
Where it's fully diminished, so we put the diminished sign. And then now, what inversion would it be in? So we have G in the bottom, and get the C.
It would be in the second.
Good. And what's the number for that? The numbers?
Oh, 6-4.
Not 6-4. Logically, it makes sense if we have this idea of a secondary harmony. That this chord really is connecting to the two. In a way, you can think of this like imagine a sentence like the fox ran past the barn. That's pretty simple. You can then say the hungry fox ran past the burning barn. And this chord here, this secondary dominant. This chromatic chord is kind of like those adjectives I added. It describes something that's already in the sentence, but it makes it more colorful. So we have this 7 diminished chord for 2-2, 2-6, first inversion. Okay, and then Michael, how about this chord here?
What's the diminished chord?
Good.
What? You have B, B, F, and A flat.
B, B, F, and A flat.
It looks like the seventh scale, building the seventh scale to me, but we have an A flat, so is it like a secondary diminished of like C minor or something?
Yeah, so good question. So A flat is not in the C major key signature, but if we try to interpret this like a secondary dominant, it would be referring us back to C, which is our tonic note anyway. So when we have a chord that comes from the parallel minor, in this case from C minor, instead of saying it's a secondary chord, we say that it's a borrowed chord. We're borrowing it from the parallel minor. And when we do that, we don't use a fancy thing with a slash. We just borrow the Roman numeral from C minor as well. So in C minor, Michael, what would the Roman numeral be for this?
7 diminished.
4-3. Exactly. And notice how here we have 7 diminished 4-3 of 2, and now we have 7 diminished 4-3, which is of 1, you could say. Yeah.
So you said the previous chord was not in C, it was in D minor.
Right. So C major scale, we don't have C sharp or B flat. Right. And this chord here, this one connects to the D minor chord here.
Connects how?
So the diminished seventh chord is a dissonant chord. Dissonant chords. out. shows you how these voices move, and then also how there's a G in the bass that goes to F. And you compare that to the C sharp, like the tritone, G in a C sharp, which is an augmented fourth. It resolves out to a major sixth. So there's a lot of clues in here that tell us that this chord connects to that. And when you listen to the music too, you can also hear how those chords are connected. So good. Yeah. So F, what from a numeral would be this? two here. And then, Stephanie, how about the next one? This one? No, careful. So start at the bottom and count up the... So it's another one on the bottom here. Oh, you're looking at that? No, this one here. So, I'm going to move a little bit faster to save on some time. Here, we have an interesting chord. We have C major, but we also have a B flat. And that makes it a dominant chord. And in, like all of these other chords, this chromatic note is part of a secondary harmony. And the secondary harmony here connects it to this next chord, which is F, which is 4. And this would be called 5, 7, of 4. So right after we have the cadence on our tonic chord, Bach does this thing where he turns our tonic chord into a dissonant chord attached to 4. So he does that in part to keep the piece from sounding like it's done. Because if you have a cadence on the one chord that's a strong cadence, it might sound like the piece is over now. So Bach undercuts his own cadence by putting in this dissonant note. Then we have these chords here.
Isn't it 4 on 7 because it has a D?
Right, 4 on 7. So this chord here still functions the same way though.
Okay.
As a dominant.
So you don't, like in the actual Roman numeral analysis, you don't have to put 5 7 of 4 7 if it leads to a 7.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
You said 5 7 4.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, then we have this kind of complicated thing that happens here. We have two dissonant chords in a row. And normally a dissonant chord in tonal music will resolve to a consonant chord right away. Occasionally, composers like Bach will prolong a dissonant state for two or more chords. And he does that here. So here we have F sharp, A, C, and E flat. That's a fully diminished seventh chord. But F sharp, E flat, these aren't notes from C major. This is another secondary chord, and this time it's borrowed from G, but from G minor. So what we would do, we put in our seven diminished seven. And then because we're in C major, we don't say G minor, we still say uppercase 5. So the thing about borrowing chords from the parallel minor is that we don't really do much besides borrow them. You know, this by itself is enough to tell us what the chord is. And then here, it's getting too fussy to say that this is from G minor, especially since two chords down, we are back to a G major kind of chord.
So even though it's a borrowed secondary dominant chord, you don't need to specify that.
Right.
Okay. Or secondary diminished chord.
Right. Okay, then we have this chord here. This is maybe one of the wackiest chords in the piece because you see here we have this little cluster of notes. This is the one case where, not the one case, this is one of the few chords where the fifth note, the extra note, is not part of the chord, but instead it's a dissonant note, a non-harmonic tone. So here, we have A flat, F, B natural, C natural, and D natural. If we arrange these into stacked thirds, we would have, start with B, D, F, A flat, C. Now, I've already said we don't really have ninth chords in tonal music. The C is a dissonant note. And so, in this case, we kind of ignore the C for right now, and the four notes that are part of the four bottom notes form our triad, which we've seen this one before too. It's our seven diminished from C minor. It's seven diminished, and this one is 4-3, and 4-2, and then here, 5-7. Look at the bass line here. We have 4-7. We have 7 diminished 7 and 5, 7 diminished 4-2, and then 5-7. The bass line was F, F sharp, A flat, G. What Bach is doing is he's kind of circling around the dominant note. so I did that kind of quickly. 5-7. This one, this is one of the more confusing Roman numerals I'm putting up here for you today. Notice I call this 5-6-4. I think I mentioned this before a little bit. But we have a tonic triad, C major, here in this case, in second inversion. We don't analyze it as 1-6-4. We analyze it as 5-6-4. And that connects to this idea here, where we have tonic, predominant, dominant, and tonic harmony types. Because when you have a tonic chord in second inversion, it's a dominant kind of harmony, not a tonic kind of harmony.
So you don't call it 1-6-4?
No, we call it 5-6-4. Okay, then here, this one, I have 5-7-4, and that's another weird number I haven't seen before. I mean 5-7, and then this one, where we have a fully diminished second chord, but it's over the pedal point. Then we have another 5-6-4 here. And this is all, musically speaking, this is Bach ramping up the tension.
Context, and I put it inside the chord.
suspensions are, even though this piece is like a chord progression, you know, this is just a arpeggio pattern and the chords that move through it. The background is based on counterpoint, on note moving against note in these melodies. And you can see, you can hear it pretty clearly if you play the outer voices. I'm going to play through those for you again so you can hear them with what we talked about kind of freshening. notice how at first it was a dominant, it's nice and bright.